But we begin tonight with the streets of London, the streets that were filled with protesters today. On the second day of President Trump's visit to London, many of the British protesters engaged in more mockery of the president than outrage against him, believing that the most hurtful attack point of this president is his vanity. The now famous Trump baby balloon floated over the protest, carrying his cell phone, presumably ready to tweet about some mayor somewhere. The president participated in another embarrassing news conference for the president and for the United States of America, in which once again, the president was exposed as not knowing what he was talking about on many fronts, most especially Brexit.
What is paramount, I believe, is delivering on Brexit for the British people. And I seem to remember the president suggested that I sued the European Union, which we didn't do. We went into negotiations and we came out with a good deal.
Yeah, that's not such a deal. I would have sued, but that's okay. I would have sued and settled, maybe, but you never know. She's probably a better negotiator than I am.
The only person in Britain or the world today who believes the British could have sued their way out of the European Union was Donald Trump. While the president was suggesting impossible legal actions to the prime minister, back in Washington, we learned today that the White House has directed former White House communications director Hope Hicks and White House counsel Don McGahn's former chief of staff, Annie Donaldson, not to comply with congressional subpoenas for documents related to their time at the White House. The majority leader in the House, Steny Hoyer, was asked today if Hope Hicks and Annie Donaldson could face contempt votes in the House.
I see every name who has either refused to respond to a congressional subpoena or request for documents, or who has been instructed by the president not to respond, is subject to being on that list.
Chairman of the House Judiciary Committee Jerry Nadler rejected a new Justice Department request to hold new negotiations over releasing redacted portions of the Mueller report. Next Tuesday, the House will vote on holding Attorney General William Barr and former White House counsel Don McGahn in contempt of Congress for not complying with congressional subpoenas. We were reminded again today that time eventually catches up with Donald Trump, as it surely will with the Mueller report, which will no doubt be handed over in full, including underlying documents, to the Congress at the latest when the next president is sworn into office, probably about a year and a half from now. Today, Vanity Fair's Gabriel Sherman has new reporting on a document that Donald Trump has been hiding for decades. Gabriel Sherman has obtained a copy of Donald Trump's prenuptial agreement with his second wife, Marla Maples, who Donald Trump divorced 4 years after marrying her. It was a very harsh deal for the second Mrs. Trump, who gave birth to Donald Trump's fourth child. In the document reported by Gabriel Sherman, but not seen by us here at MSNBC, Donald Trump listed his net worth at just over $1 billion, but provided his second wife with a one-time payout of only $1 million, plus child support for their daughter, Tiffany Trump. The agreement specifies that financial support for Tiffany Trump would end immediately if she joined the military or the Peace Corps, the kind of thing no Trump has ever even thought about doing. Joining us now is Gabe Sherman, a Vanity Fair special correspondent and an MSNBC contributor. Also joining us, Tim O'Brien. He's the executive editor of Bloomberg Opinion and an MSNBC contributor. He has reported on Donald Trump for decades and written a book about him. And Ron Klain is with us. He's a former senior aide to Vice President Joe Biden and President Obama and a former chief counsel to the Senate Judiciary Committee. Gabe, let me begin with you and the prenuptial agreement.
Yeah.
Is that a document that you're going to produce and make public?
I mean, that's something that I have to discuss with my editors. I have the physical copy of it. It's 50 pages.
And the editors at Vanity Fair have seen it?
Oh, of course. Yeah,
lawyers,
the fact checkers. Oh, yeah, yeah. It's been through all the rigorous publishing process. And, you know, it's revealing in two ways. One, it shows the degree to which Trump would inflate, and Tim has written a lot about this as well, just lie about his net worth. This was as his casinos were going through a very infamous now bankruptcy, and yet he was claiming the value of his Taj Mahal casino was over $1.2 billion. No one would verify that that is an act. Even his accountants, as I report, in the financial statement that's included in the prenup, his accountants say, we have not audited the value of these assets. So that's one thing. The second thing is just how brutally tough this was on Marla Maples, that he basically drew out these negotiations until the eve of their wedding. She had just given birth to their daughter, Tiffany. She wanted to get married, and he really squeezed her. And I think this is just, again, a window into Donald Trump's private life, the degree to which, you know, these relationships are, you know, based purely on what is in his financial interest.
And she got no alimony in this deal, no ongoing support, and the $1 million. And you make it a point in this that, the, as divorce lawyers have told you, that overstating your worth in one of these reports, there's no penalty for that.
No downside.
You would only get in legal trouble if you understated.
Of course.
And so he was stuck with the dilemma of he's trying to lowball her on any possible future divorce, but at the same time, he doesn't want a document out there anywhere that indicates he's not a billionaire.
Of course. And, you know, this was the five-year period between 1990 and 1995 that he did not appear on the Forbes list of billionaires. You know, clearly his net worth was at its low point. I mean, really the only hard assets that he showed was about $139 million in cash, a lot of which, as the New York Times has been reported, was handed to him by his father, Fred Trump. So, you know, this was a case where he was, you know, trying to paint a picture of being a master of the universe when, in fact, he was clearly nowhere near that.
And you mentioned how this marriage number two ended, which is something that's also covered in Michael Wolff's new book. Michael's going to be joining us later in this hour. And the precipitating event was the second Mrs. Trump being caught on the beach in Florida with one of the Trump security guards.
Yes, and ironically enough, it was reported in the National Enquirer, which at that time was not the Trump organ that it would become in the 2016 election.
One of the lessons that Donald Trump had to get in business with the Enquirer.
Of course, yes. And this was reported, and someone who spoke to Trump right at the time it was reported said he just went completely nuclear. But tellingly, he did not want to leave Marla Maples right at that point, because then it would make him look like he was the, you know, the cheated on spouse. So he bided his time and waited about a year, and then he formally separated with her about a year before the prenup's terms expired. So he basically waited until this deal was about to expire and then left her so that she only got the $1 million.
Tim O'Brien, is this one of those moments where, with Gabe revealing a prenuptial agreement of wife number two in Trump world, that you have every right to now believe that eventually it's all going to come out? The documents will eventually find their way to the surface.
One can only hope. I think what we're getting, obviously, is the bookends of Donald Trump from 1993 and Donald Trump to the presidency. And what happened in between, there was a lot of smoke and mirrors. And, you know, he not only was running out of money at the time they struck that prenup, he was almost personally bankrupt. He had to go to the family and ask them for money. And even his own siblings didn't want to give him a dime. They ended up forcing him to pledge his future share of Fred's estate in order to get enough money to keep him from going bankrupt. And I think all of the documentation that's been coming out piecemeal from the, you know, early 90s to the present shows that there's much less there than he ever said. And I think the business press knew that for a long time. I think there were shades of it out there, but no one ever actually knew how deeply bad it was. And it was bad.
One thing that I get, Tim, from your reporting for years on Donald Trump, Gabe, from your reporting, including this, Michael Wolff's reporting, is this consistent picture. The picture is consistent. As to the specifics of every little tiny bit of evidence that's accumulated to create this picture, there's no conflict. No one's come out with a different image of Donald Trump that conflicts with the guy who would do this kind of prenup and who would behave the way he does in his marriages, as you've reported in your book, as Michael reports in his.
Yeah, I mean, this is the strange situation where it's all on the surface. America knew and knows who this man was, and yet they still elected him president. So I think there's no mystery as to who Donald Trump is. I think we're just shading in lines of the portrait and making a more detailed picture as more and more of these documents come out.
It's also a reminder of how quickly people forget, because he was the sort of the punchline to jokes about the excesses of the 80s and 90s until The Apprentice came along. And The Apprentice completely completely recast him in the imagination of most Americans. And that's what he wrote into the presidency on.
Yeah, Ron Klain, everywhere except New York City, where everybody here in New York City knew what the real Donald Trump was, and no one fell for that, as the voting results showed on election night. Ron, to put all of this, this accumulation of new information about Donald Trump, reaching back to a prenup with wife number two, into where we are today in Congress, with Congress trying to obtain documents, through subpoena. The fight, they're going to have to fight for every page of these documents through subpoena. But is it your belief that eventually, even if it takes another presidency 2 years from now, eventually all of this will come up?
Yeah, Lawrence, and I think faster than that. I mean, I think it's worth remembering that just 4 weeks ago, we got Donald Trump's tax returns from this very same period, from 1985 to 1994, documents that had been secret for 20 years. And so what you're seeing in rapid succession is this information about Trump in this period of time starting to come to light. This citadel of secrecy that he built around his private life starting to unravel. It's no surprise, right? The heat is on Trump. His fixer is now in jail, Michael Cohen. The subpoenas are flying. The pressure's on. And maybe people who were scared of Donald Trump are just less scared before. And so in rapid order, we get 10 years of tax returns. We get this prenuptial agreement. I think the pressure is building. I think he scares people less than he used to. I think he's got less of an apparatus around him to keep this stuff secret. And I think the personal secrets are going to come out. And I think the secrets he's suppressing from Congress are going to come out in pretty quick order here.
Ron, one of the things you get from Michael Wolff's book, which I think is one of those reinforcing images that was somewhere in our minds anyway, but he has the real evidence for it and descriptions of this kind of attitude from people inside the White House, is that Donald Trump is going to fight every single thing. There won't be one reasonable accommodation with Congress as this investigation goes on, and he's willing to lie about anything at any time. Congress has never dealt with something like that.
Well, I agree with that, Lawrence, but I also think there's one interesting point today in this fight over Hope Hicks's documents, which she has largely refused to turn over, which is she has in her possession White House documents as an ex-White House official. And so it's a reminder that no matter how hard Trump fights, there are a lot of people around him who have this paper, who walked out of the building with files, who walked out of the building with records or emails or whatever. And Congress is going to squeeze those folks, as you heard Steny Hoyer say, contempt vote next week in the Congress. And the question is, who will take the fall for Trump? And maybe less and less, fewer and fewer people will as the pressure mounts. Mm-hmm.
Gabe Sherman, on Hope Hicks, what is your expectation of how she will handle herself in this?
Well, you know, clearly she will still very loyal to the president. Although she left the White House, she remains very loyal to Donald Trump and Ivanka Trump and the Trump family. So I don't see really any scenario in which somehow, unless she faces extreme legal jeopardy, maybe a contempt vote, that she would not toe the White House line. There's no incentive for her to break ranks.
You know, Tim, you mentioned that Donald Trump got elected. Everybody knew all these negative things about him. I think there was a general picture of some of negativity that came out during the campaign. But when I look at the details in both Michael Wolff's new book and I look into your book, where you quote him, he's talking to you directly. You have this on audio tape. Donald Trump says to you about wife number two, "I was bored when she was walking down the aisle." America did not read your book.
No, they, I think
they,
that's
they
true.
Don't know details like that.
What I meant to say was I think that The Apprentice actually caused this sort of mass amnesia about this earlier period. I think The Apprentice recast him. And I think between The Apprentice and his presidency, I agree with you. I don't think people were reading these kind of details. Mm-hmm. I think people are paying attention now because they recognize the gravity of what his presidency means. And of course, the extent to which his character comes into play. You know, it's amazing to me when he told me that anecdote about Marla, he was about to get married to Melania. He had no reason to scalp his ex-wife in an interview with a journalist. And I, of course, had to go back to Marla to fact check this. And when I spoke with her on the phone, she audibly gasped because she was hurt. Mm-hmm. And you know, there's this side of Trump that is so ruthless that he will play cat and mouse even with ex-wives who are completely petrified of crossing him in any way. Well,
and I should point out, in the prenup, in the documents I viewed, there's an extensive non-disclosure provision in the prenup that Marla agrees, both parties, in fact, agree not to speak about details of the marriage, not to write a memoir, not to have any public comment about their marriage. And yet here's Donald Trump with Tim O'Brien basically just violating that, you know, front and center. It's crazy that, you know, but if she did that, if Marla Maples gave an interview and said anything about Donald Trump, you know he would have lawyers on her like, next day, night.
Gabe Sherman, Tim O'Brien, Ron Klain, thank you all for starting us off tonight. Thanks for checking out our YouTube channel. Subscribe by clicking on the button below for more from The Last Word and the rest of MSNBC.